Grande parte do conhecimento do público em geral sobre homicídio em série é um produto de representações sensacionalizadas e estereotipadas pela mídia. Histórias coloridas são escritas para despertar o interesse do público, não para mostrar uma imagem precisa do assassino. Ao focar na imagem da vida desses predadores socialmente construídos ou não, o público fica cativado pela apresentação estilizada desses criminosos, ao invés de se aterrorizar com a dura realidade de seus crimes, e não de sua vida. Os estereótipos da mídia e a hipérbole criam mitos e grandes distorções na consciência pública em relação às verdadeiras dinâmicas e padrões de assassinatos em série. Mas a mídia não está sozinha na deturpação e glamorização desses acontecimentos. Os profissionais da aplicação da lei também divulgam informações incorretas e estereótipos sobre homicídios em série devido à dependência de informações anedóticas, em vez de padrões cientificamente documentados de comportamentos desses assassinos. Talvez isso não deva surpreender, porque os profissionais envolvidos em certas investigações, incluindo detetives, promotores e patologistas, geralmente têm uma exposição prévia muito limitada a esses casos. Desde o início do canal Paralelo Metafórico, eu recebo uma verdadeira enxurrada de pedidos para falar sobre Ted Bundy. Por muito tempo, me neguei em sentar e escrever alguma coisa sobre ele. Primeiro, porque praticamente tudo sobre a sua história já foi contado, não só aqui no YouTube, mas em todos os meios de comunicação, inclusive filmes. Segundo, porque eu venho notado que nos últimos anos, algumas pessoas parecem ter se compadecido desta criatura nojenta, o transformando em uma espécie de símbolo de alguma causa neurótica perdida. E sinceramente, não me sinto bem em nutrir em outras pessoas um sentimento nem que seja pequeno de qualquer tipo de admiração para este sujeito. Dar visibilidade a este tipo de criatura é no mínimo inconsequente, porém, eu precisava falar dele, para que não fosse esquecido, assim como muitos outros assassinos que abordo aqui no canal. Mas, deixo claro que o Paralelo Metafórico não é um ambiente de serial killer. Apesar dos milhares de pedidos diários, o nosso foco é contar histórias. Todos os tipos de histórias que, de alguma forma, influenciaram ou influenciam a sociedade como um todo. E essas histórias nem sempre terminam com finais felizes. Alegando insanidade ou não, fruto de uma sociedade podre, maldade nata, ou qualquer outra justificativa que possa tentar relevar os atos de Ted Bundy, eu gostaria de deixar claro que o mundo da psiquiatria forense é muito amplo. Inúmeros escritores do meio divergem entre si. E quando eu explano sobre alguns desses monstros no canal, levo em consideração o que já foi escrito sobre ele, não necessariamente sendo a minha opinião particular. Afinal de contas, não posso me podar em falar sobre as opiniões de especialistas formados em detrimento das minhas próprias crenças particulares. O que procuro aqui é contar a história, procurando abordar da melhor forma possível e imparcial. Mas, às vezes não consigo, como é o caso do vídeo de hoje. Assassinos em série são sempre presentes na sociedade. No entanto, as estatísticas revelam que o homicídio em série é bastante raro e representa uma pequena porção de todos os assassinatos cometidos no mundo. Desinformação persistente, estereótipos e hipérboles apresentados na mídia se combinaram com a relativa raridade desses tipos de assassinato para promover uma série de mitos populares sobre essas atrocidades. E mesmo que seja inacreditável, alguns ainda tentam justificar mortes, seja sob quaisquer circunstâncias. Talvez por isso, os mitos mais comuns sobre assassinos em série abrangem fatores como raça, gênero, inteligência, condições de vida e características de suas vítimas. Mesmo assim, tenham em mente uma coisa. Independentemente de sexo, infância e motivações, reitero o que sempre falo em meus vídeos. Nada nessa vida justifica o assassinato de uma pessoa inocente. Todos que cometem atos contra terceiros merecem ser julgados e condenados de acordo com a lei de seu país. E ao sentir pena de um assassino, por mais justificado que tenha sido seu ato, é uma atitude covarde e inconsequente, tanto com os familiares quanto com as vítimas desses monstros. Para entender um pouco mais sobre a minha linha de pensamento, se quiser, eu gostaria de indicar a leitura de Teorias sobre a Maldade Humana. Estes casos são abordados por dois grandes pensadores que discordavam entre si, Thomas Hobbes e Jean-Jacques Rousseau. Vale muito a pena a leitura e ver a discordância entre ambos para tecermos uma linha de pensamento própria. Não é questão de ter razão ou não, mas sim de perceber que assuntos complexos merecem e devem ser debatidos. Eu, por exemplo, nunca me nego a alguns debates aqui no canal. A discordância de opiniões nos torna racionais e seres humanos melhores, capazes de compreender os vários lados da mesma moeda. Ted Bundy é, talvez, o assassino em série mais famoso e estranhamente popular de todos os tempos. Milhões de pessoas ainda são fascinadas por ele, mesmo 31 anos após a sua morte por execução. Isso se deve, em grande parte, aos documentários e filmes sobre a sua vida. Mas, sem dúvida, ele era um psicopata astuto, mesmo que encantador, que sequestrou, estuprou e matou mais de 30 mulheres em 7 estados americanos entre os anos de 1974 e 1978. Bundy costumava abordar as suas vítimas em locais públicos, fingindo ferimentos ou incapacidade e até mesmo personificando uma figura de autoridade. Depois disso, ele as dominava, agredia e matava em locais isolados. Às vezes, revisitava os corpos de suas vítimas, cuidando e realizando atos sexuais com os cadáveres em decomposição, até que a putrefação e a destruição por animais selvagens tornasse impossível qualquer tipo de contato. Um comportamento frio e sem emoção, combinado com um intelecto aguçado e personalidade encantadora, fez de um assassino psicopata como Bundy um predador muito eficaz. Ele não tinha empatia interpessoal e era incapaz de sentir pena ou remorso. Não valorizava a vida humana, nem se importava com as consequências de seus crimes. Ted Bundy era totalmente insensível, indiferente e extremamente brutal com suas vítimas. Em termos de classificação forense, Bundy é conhecido como um serial killer de poder e controle. A principal motivação deste tipo de assassino é dominar suas vítimas. Mas Bundy ia além. Ele gostava de torturar sua presa e a achava sexualmente excitante, e foi no ato do assassinato que ele encontrou sua expressão mais satisfatória e final de poder e controle sobre suas vítimas. Ele era paciente e normalmente matava suas vítimas lentamente para prolongar o seu próprio prazer sádico. Esse comportamento era fortalecedor, porque ele decidia quando, como e em que circunstâncias suas vítimas morreriam. O homem agredia sexualmente suas vítimas, mas não era motivado simplesmente pela luxúria. Em vez disso, o estupro era outro meio de dominação e controle de suas vítimas. Bundy não perdia o interesse em suas vítimas mesmo depois delas serem mortas. Às vezes, como dito, ele voltava ao local de desova dos corpos para fazer sexo com o cadáver em decomposição, mesmo muito tempo depois do assassinato, para que assim ele pudesse perpetuar o seu domínio e controle sobre o falecido. Como a necrofilia elimina totalmente a possibilidade de rejeição indesejada, um assassino de poder e controle como Bundy pode retornar para violar a vítima sempre que bem entender. Isso deu a este psicopata uma tremenda sensação de empoderamento, evitando a perspectiva perturbadora de rejeição e decepção por uma pessoa viva. Impulsionado por fantasias homicidas obsessivas, Ted se sentia na obrigação de matar várias vezes para satisfazer os seus terríveis desejos. No entanto, a realidade brutal e confusa do assassinato em si nunca cumpria completamente a promessa de fantasia que ele tinha em sua mente. De fato, as consequências das mortes geralmente resultavam em uma decepção emocional para ele. Mas mesmo assim, a fantasia não desaparecia, porque ela estava profundamente enraizada em sua mente e psique. Ted Bundy disse certa vez: "A fantasia que acompanha e gera a excitação que antecede o crime é sempre mais estimulante do que as consequências imediatas do próprio crime." Quando um serial killer como Bundy ficava desapontado por não ter experimentado sua fantasia final na vida real, exatamente da maneira como ele a imaginava, ele continuava matando na tentativa de alcançar esta fantasia ideal. Essa é a natureza obsessiva, compulsiva e cíclica deste assassino em série incomum. Bundy também guardava o que ele chamava de troféus, ou lembranças de seus crimes, que serviam para sustentar e reabastecer suas fantasias violentas e sexuais. Quando perguntaram para ele por que tirava fotos de suas vítimas, ele disse: "Quando você trabalha duro para fazer algo dar certo, não quer que seja esquecido facilmente." E não era só isso. Ele guardava essas lembranças, como uma mecha de cabelo, joias, carteiras de identidade ou até um recorte de jornal do crime. E isso o ajudava a prolongar e até nutrir fantasias mais secretas. Entre um assassinato e outro, ou enquanto ele escolhia suas futuras vítimas, Bundy costumava pegar os seus ditos troféus para ajudá-lo a reviver seus assassinatos passados através de fantasias perturbadoras. Isso lhe dava algum tipo de satisfação e o incentivava a continuar. Esses troféus também ajudavam o assassino a recordar cada uma de suas vítimas. Às vezes, ele dava itens como joias a uma amiga ou conhecida. Geralmente, quem recebia esses troféus eram pessoas conhecidas ou quem ele nutria algum tipo de admiração, ao ponto de não querer matá-la, mas gratificá-la com tal troféu, sem que a pessoa soubesse, é claro, a sua origem. Como um cachorro que corre para pegar um brinquedo e entrega satisfeito o item especial ao seu dono, Ted Bundy gostava de dar outros significados aos itens que roubava de suas vítimas. Em particular, ele dava uma joia para uma mulher e dizia: "Veja o que eu encontrei na rua. Eu quero que fique com você." Mais tarde, quando ele via o seu troféu sendo usado por sua amiga ou conhecida, isso o excitava, fazendo parte de seu jogo secreto e sombrio. Ele olhava para ela, usando as joias de alguém que havia assassinado, e fantasiava sobre a vítima que estuprou e matou para adquiri-lo. Certa vez, ele disse: "Se ela soubesse que o colar que estava usando veio de alguém que eu matei." Mas não, isso fazia parte do jogo e me deixava louco. Depois de ser preso no Colorado em 1975, Bundy planejou duas fugas dramáticas da prisão e cometeu outras agressões, incluindo 3 assassinatos, antes de sua última captura na Flórida, em 1978. Ele foi executado na cadeira elétrica da prisão estadual da Flórida em 24 de janeiro de 1989. Sua combinação única de charme, boa aparência, intelecto aguçado, instinto dominador, personalidade psicopática e sangue frio fez de Ted Bundy um prolífico assassino em série, quase uma máquina de matar perfeita, que continua a nos deixar perplexos com suas atrocidades até os dias de hoje. Mas admirar um ser tão cruel assim é demais para mim. Este humano imundo subjugava mulheres indefesas à procura de carinho e companhia das piores formas que se possa imaginar. Para mim, o inferno é pouco para ele. E não há sequer um traço de vida deste homem que justifique os seus atos. Ele era mau porque gostava de ser mau. Se embebedando em sua própria paranoia doentia, Ted Bundy deixou a sua marca no mundo das ciências criminais e merece ser renegado à sarjeta da história, mas jamais esquecido, para que outros doentes como ele saibam o que acontece com pessoas medíocres como este ser, que sequer pode ser chamado de humano. Bom, este foi o vídeo de hoje. Espero imensamente que tenham gostado. E como sempre, nos vemos nos comentários. Até mais.
Ted, it is about 2:30 in the afternoon. You are scheduled to be executed tomorrow morning at 7:00 if you don't receive another stay. What is going through your mind? What thoughts have you had in these last few days?
Well, I won't kid you to say that it's something that I feel that I am in control of or something that I've come to terms with, because I haven't. It's a moment-by-moment thing. Sometimes I feel very tranquil, and other times I don't feel tranquil at all. What's going through my mind right now is to use the minutes and hours that I have left as fruitfully as possible and see what happens. It helps to live in the moment, in the essence that we use it productively. So right now I'm feeling calm, and in large part because I'm here with you.
For the record, you are guilty of killing many women and girls.
Yes. Yes. That's true.
Ted, how did it happen? Take me back. What are the antecedents of the behavior that we've seen? So much grief, so much sorrow, so much pain for so many people. Where did it start? How did this moment come about?
That's the question of the hour, and one that not only people much more intelligent than I have been working on for years, but one that I've been working on for years and trying to understand. Is there enough time to explain it all? I don't know. I think I understand it, though. Understand what happened to me, to the extent that I can see how certain feelings and ideas developed in me to the point where I began to act out on them. Certain very violent and very destructive feelings.
All right, let's go back then to those roots. First of all, you, as I understand it, were raised in what you consider to have been a healthy home.
Absolutely.
You were not physically abused. You were not sexually abused. You were not emotionally abused.
No, no way. And that's part of the tragedy of this whole situation, is because I grew up in a wonderful home with two dedicated and loving parents, one of five brothers and sisters. A home where we as children were the focus of my parents' lives, where we regularly attended church. Two Christian parents who did not drink, they did not smoke, there was no gambling, there was no physical abuse or fighting in the home. I'm not saying this was Leave It to Beaver.
It wasn't a perfect home.
No, I don't know that such a home exists, but it was a fine, solid Christian home, and nobody, I hope no one will try to take the easy way out and to try to blame or otherwise accuse my family of contributing to this, because I know, and I'm trying to tell you as honestly as I know how, what happened, and I think this is a message I'm going to get across. But as a young boy, and I mean a boy of 12 or 13, certainly, that I encountered outside the home again, in the local grocery store, or the local drug store, the softcore pornography, what people call softcore. But as I think I explained to you last night, Dr. Dobson, in an anecdote, as young boys do, we explored the back roads and sideways and byways of our neighborhood, and oftentimes people would dump the garbage and whatever they were cleaning out of their house, and from time to time we'd come across pornographic books of a harder nature than graphic, you might say, more explicit nature than we would encounter, let's say, in your local grocery store. And this also included such things as, let's say, detective magazines and more
hardcore. Those that involve violence.
Yes. And I this is something I think I want to emphasize, is the most damaging kinds of pornography. And I'm talking from personal experience, hard, real personal experience. The most damaging kinds of pornography are those that involve violence and sexual violence. Because the wedding of those two forces, as I know only too well, brings about behavior that is just too terrible to describe.
Now, walk me through that. What was going on in your mind at that time?
Okay, before we go any further, I think it's important to me, and that people believe what I'm saying, to tell you that I'm not blaming pornography, and not saying that it caused me to go out and do certain things, that I take full responsibility for whatever I've done and all the things that I've done. That's not the question here. The question and the issue is how this kind of literature contributed and helped mold and shape the kinds of violent behavior.
It fueled your fantasies, though.
Well, in the beginning, it fuels this kind of thought process. Then, at a certain time, it's instrumental in what I would say crystallizing it, making it into something which is almost like a separate entity inside. And at that point, you're at the verge, or I was at the verge of acting out on these kinds of thoughts.
Now, I really want to understand that. You had gone about as far as you could go in your own fantasy life, mm-hmm. with printed material, and you made, or printed and video or film or
film, magazines, yeah. What have you. Yeah.
And then there was the urge to take that little step or big step over to a physical event.
And it happens, it happened in stages, gradually. It doesn't necessarily, not to me at least, happen overnight. My experience with, I'd say, pornography generally, but with pornography that deals on a violent level with sexuality, is that once you become addicted to it, and I look at this as a kind of addiction, like other kinds of addiction, I would keep looking for more potent, more explicit, more graphic kinds of material. Like an addiction, you keep craving something which is harder, something which gives you a greater sense of excitement. Until you reach the point where the pornography only goes so far. You reach that jumping off point where you begin to wonder if maybe actually doing it will give you that which is beyond just reading about it or looking at it.
How long did you stay at that point before you actually assaulted someone?
Well, yeah, you see, that is a very delicate point in my own development. And we're talking about having reached the point or a gray area that surrounded that point over a course of years.
You don't remember how long that
was? Well, I would say a couple of years. And what was I was dealing with there were very strong inhibitions against criminal behavior, violent behavior that had been conditioned into me, bred into me, in my environment, in my neighborhood, in my church, in my school. Things which said, no, this is wrong. I mean, even to think of it is wrong, but certainly to do it is wrong. And I'm on that edge, and the last vestiges of restraint, the barriers to actually doing something were being tested constantly, and assailed through the kind of fantasy life that was fueled largely by pornography.
Do you remember what pushed you over that edge? Do you remember the decision to go for it? Do you remember where you decided to throw caution to the wind?
Again, when you say pushed, I know what you're saying. I don't want to infer again.
I understand that.
That I was some helpless kind of a victim, and yet we're talking about an influence that is the influence of violent types of media and violent pornography, which was an indispensable link in the chain of behavior, the chain of events that led to the behaviors, to the assaults, to the murders, and what have you. It's a very difficult thing to describe. The sensation, of reaching that point where I knew that it was like something had, say, snapped, that I knew that I couldn't control it anymore, that these barriers that I had learned as a child, that had been instilled in me, were not enough to hold me back with respect to seeking out and harming somebody.
Would it be accurate to call that a frenzy, a sexual frenzy?
Well, yes, that's one way to describe it, a compulsion, a building up of this destructive energy. Another factor here that I haven't mentioned is the use of alcohol, but I think that what alcohol did in conjunction with, let's say, my exposure to pornography with alcohol reduced my inhibitions at the same time. The fantasy life that was fueled by pornography eroded them further.
In the early days, you were nearly always about half drunk when you did these things, is that right?
Yes, yes.
Was that always true?
I would say that was generally the case. Yeah. Almost without exception.
All right, if I can understand it now, there's this battle going on within. There are the conventions that you've been taught. There's the right and wrong that you learned as a child. Mm-hmm. And then there is this unbridled passion fueled by your plunge into hardcore violent pornography. And those things are at war with each other.
Yes.
And then with the alcohol diminishing the inhibitions, you let go.
Well, yes, and you can summarize it that way, and that's accurate, certainly. And it just occurred to me that some people would say that, well, I've seen that stuff, and it doesn't do anything to me. And I can understand that. I don't. Virtually everyone can be exposed to so-called pornography, and while they're aroused to it to one degree or another, not go out and do anything wrong.
Now, the addictions are like that. They affect some people more than they affect others.
Well,
but there is a percentage of people affected by hardcore pornography in a very violent way, and you're obviously one of them.
That was a major component, and I don't know why I was vulnerable to it. All I know is that it had an impact on me that was just so central to the development of the violent behavior that I engaged in.
Ted, after you committed your first murder, what was the emotional effect on you? What happened in the days after that?
Well, again, this, please understand that even all these years later, it's very difficult to talk about it, and reliving it through talking about it is difficult, to say the least, but I want you to understand what happened. It was like coming out of some kind of horrible trance or dream. I can only liken it to after, you know, I don't want to over-dramatize it, but to have been possessed by something so awful and so alien, and then the next morning wake up from it, remember what happened, and realize that basically, I mean, in the eyes of the law, certainly in the eyes of God, you're responsible. To wake up in the morning and realize what I had done, and with a clear mind and all my essential moral and ethical feelings intact at that moment, absolutely horrified that I was capable of doing something like that.
You really hadn't known that before?
There is just absolutely no way to describe first the brutal urge to do that kind of thing, and then what happens is once it has been more or less satisfied and received, you might say, or spent, that sense, that kind of energy level recedes, and basically I became myself again. I want people to understand this too, and I'm not saying this gratuitously because it's important people understand this, that basically I was a normal person. I wasn't some guy hanging out at bars or a bum, or I wasn't a pervert in the sense that, you know, people look at somebody and say, I know there's something wrong with him, and just tell. I mean, I was essentially a normal person. I had good friends. I led a normal life, except for this one small but very potent and very destructive segment of it that I kept very secret, very close to myself, and didn't let anybody know about it. And part of the shock and horror for my dear friends and family years ago when I was first arrested was that there was no clue. They looked at me and they looked at the all-American boy. And I wasn't perfect, but I want to be quite candid with you. I was okay. Okay. I was. The basic humanity and the basic spirit that God gave me was intact, but it unfortunately became overwhelmed at times.
Mm-hmm. You feel this really deeply, don't you? Ted, outside these walls right now, there are several hundred reporters that wanted to talk to you.
Yeah.
And you asked me to come here from California because you had something you wanted to say. This hour that we have together is not just an interview with a man who's scheduled to die tomorrow morning. I'm here and you're here because of this message that you're talking about right here. You really feel that hardcore pornography and the doorway to it, softcore pornography, is doing untold damage to other people and causing other women to be abused and killed the way you did others.
Listen, I'm no social scientist and I haven't done a survey. I mean, I don't pretend that I know what John Q. Citizen thinks about this. But I've lived in prison for a long time now. And I've met a lot of men who were motivated to commit violence just like me. And without exception, every one of them was deeply involved in pornography without question, without exception, deeply influenced and consumed by an addiction to pornography. There's no question about it. The FBI's own study on serial homicide shows that the most common interest among serial killers is pornography.
Yeah, that's true.
And it's real. It's true.
Ted, what would your life have been like without that influence? You can only speculate.
Yeah. Well, I know it would have been far better, not just for me, and it's, excuse me for being so self-centered here. It would have been a lot better for me and lots of other people. I know that lots of other innocent people, victims and families. It would have been a lot better. There's no question but that it would have been a fuller life. Certainly a life that would not have involved, I'm absolutely certain, would not have involved this kind of violence that I have been, that I have committed.
I'm sure, Ted, if I were able to ask you the questions that are being asked out there, one of the most important as you come down to perhaps your final hours, are you thinking about all those victims out there and their families who are so wounded, you know, years later, their lives have not returned to normal. They will never return to normal.
Absolutely.
Are you carrying that load, that weight? Is the remorse there?
Again, I know that people will accuse me of being self-serving, but we're beyond that now. I mean, I'm just telling you how I feel. But through God's help, I've been able to come to the point where much too late, but better late than never, feel the hurt and the pain that I am responsible for. Yes, absolutely. In the past few days, myself and a number of investigators have been talking about unsolved cases, murders that I was involved in. And it's hard to talk about all these years later because it revives in me all those terrible feelings and those thoughts that I have steadfastly and diligently dealt with, and I think successfully, with the love of God. And yet it's reopened that, and I felt the pain and I felt the horror again of all that. And I can only hope that those who I have harmed, those who I've caused so much grief, even if they don't believe my expression of sorrow and remorse, will believe what I'm saying now, that there is loose in their towns and their communities people like me today whose dangerous impulses are being fueled day in and day out by violence in the media in its various forms, particularly sexualized violence. And what scares me, and let's come into the present now, because what I'm talking about happened 20, 30 years ago, that is, in my formative stages. And what scares and appalls me, Dr. Dobson, is when I see what's on cable TV, some of the movies, I mean, some of the violence in the movies are, they come into homes today with stuff that they wouldn't show in X-rated adult theaters 30 years ago. This stuff.
The slasher movies that you're talking about.
That stuff is, I'm telling you, from personal experience, the most, that is graphic violence on screen, particularly as it gets into the home to children who may be unattended or unaware that they may be a Ted Bundy who has that vulnerability to that predisposition to be influenced by that kind of behavior, by that kind of movie, that kind of violence. There are kids sitting out there switching the TV dial around and come upon these movies late at night, or I don't know when they're on, but they're on and any kid can watch them. It's scary when I think what would have happened to me if I had seen. I mean, scary enough. I mean, that I just ran into stuff outside the home, but to know that children are watching that kind of thing today, or can pick up their phone and dial away for it or send away for it.
Can you help me understand this desensitization process that took place? What was going on in your mind?
Well, by desensitization, I describe it in specific terms is that each time I'd harm someone, each time I'd kill someone, there'd be an enormous amount, especially at first, enormous amount of horror, guilt, remorse afterwards. But then that impulse to do it again would come back even stronger. Now, believe me, I didn't. The unique thing about how this worked, Dr. Dobson, is that I still felt in my regular life the full range of guilt and remorse about other things, regret and...
But you had this compartmentalized...
This compartmentalized, very well-focused, very sharply focused area where it was like a black hole. It was like a crack, and everything that fell into that crack just disappeared. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. One of the final murders that you committed, of course, was apparently little Kimberly Leach, 12 years of age. I think the public outcry is greater there because an innocent child was taken from a playground. What did you feel after that? Were there the normal emotions 3 days later? Where were you, Ted?
I can't really talk about that right now. That's
too painful.
I would like to be able to convey to you what that experience is like, but I can't. I won't be able to talk about that.
Okay.
I can't begin to understand. Well, I can try, but I'm aware that I can't begin to understand the pain that the parents of these children that I have, and these young women that I have harmed, feel. And I can't restore really much to them, if anything. And I won't pretend to, and I don't even expect them to forgive me, and I'm not asking for it. That kind of forgiveness is of God, and if they have it, they have it. If they don't, well, maybe they'll find it someday.
Do you deserve the punishment the state has inflicted upon you?
That's a very good question. And I'll answer very, very honestly. I don't want to die. I'm not going to kid you. I'll kid you not. I deserve certainly the most extreme punishment society has. And I deserve, I think society deserves to be protected from me and from others like me. That's for sure. I think what I hope will come of our discussion is I think society deserves to be protected from itself, because as we've been talking, there are forces at loose in this country, particularly again this kind of violent pornography, where on the one hand well-meaning decent people will condemn behavior of a Ted Bundy while they're walking past a magazine rack full of the very kinds of things that send young kids down the road to be Ted Bundys. That's the irony. We're talking here not just about more. What I'm talking about is going beyond retribution, which is what people want with me. Going beyond retribution and punishment, because there is no way in the world that killing me is going to restore those beautiful children to their parents and correct.
Ted, as you would imagine, there's tremendous cynicism about you on the outside, and I suppose for good reason. I'm not sure that there's anything that you could say that people would believe. Some people would believe.
Yeah.
And yet, you told me last night, and I have heard this through our mutual friend John Tanner, that you have accepted the forgiveness of Jesus Christ and are a follower and a believer in Him. Do you draw strength from that as you approach these final hours?
I do. I can't say that
it's gonna be
being
easy.
In the valley of the shadow of death is something that I've become all that accustomed to, and then I'm strong and nothing's bothering me. Listen, it's no fun. It gets kind of lonely, and yet I have to remind myself that every one of us will go through this someday, yes, in one way or another, and countless millions who have walked this earth before us have. So this is just an experience which we all share.